Hello and welcome to part two of the water mixable oil painting course. So in this course we're busy looking at the Daler-Rowney water mixable oil paints and we're putting them through their paces. So for this class we are going to take a look at painting alla prima, in other words painting your whole painting in one sitting, wet in wet. So we're going to take a look and see how do we do that, when do we use water, when do we not use water, and so on. So it's going to be great fun because I've got a lovely painting which I think is going to work beautifully for testing the alla prima. So let me show you what that looks like. So I found this lovely picture of a parrot on Pixabay. So it's got some lovely intense colors and it's got quite a few colors. So it's going to allow us to play around a bit with the color mixing of the water mixable oil paints, plus play around with the vibrancy and contrasts that we can get with the water mixable oil paints. So I'm really looking forward to it. So below the video you will see that there's a handout which has the template for this bird in it. So I'm working on a Daler-Rowney simply stretched canvas. It's a 16 by 20 size. So the template looks like that. It's basically four tiled pages. So what you're going to do is you're going to print those four tiled pages out and then you're just going to align them because there's a little bit of an overlap in each of these guys. So then you just line them up so that they match and then you stick them with sellotape until they meet. So the photo that I got was cropped sort of from there to there. When we're painting, however, if we had to paint this guy just like that, it's not going to work quite so well, because whenever you've got a person or an animal or something like that that can see, that can look, you have to add something that we call looking room, which means it needs some space over here on this side to look into, because this bird is looking that way. So you need some space to look into that way. If we paint this guy, then can you see what's happening? The edge of the canvas is right here, so we haven't got much looking room for the bird. So what I've done is I've taken the template and I've moved it up just that much, which is what, 5 or 6 centimeters, 2 inches. So in the end of the day we're going to have that. And that's just increased the looking room over there. So we've got more space on this side than we have on that side of the head. And that gives you the looking room that we need in order to give us a nice feeling composition. So that when you look at this, it doesn't feel like the bird is staring into the edge of the canvas. All right. So when we tackling an artwork like this, we're going to do this one quite simple. So if you're an absolute beginner, fantastic, this is the painting for you. We always start with whatever's at the back and then we work our way forward, and the reason why we do that is to get the overlapping correct. When you're overlapping objects, so by painting the background first and then the foreground objects in front of it, then you get correct overlapping. So let's say, for example, this here is now your background that you've painted. Now you paint something in front of it. Can you see what happens? You've got a beautiful, perfect overlapping. I think, let me show it on this camera over here. You've got beautiful overlapping. Instantly, you've got distance. But now what happens is, if you paint the front object first, and now you try and paint the background afterwards, you tend to squeeze it around it, and then you get this kind of an effect. Now look what happens, they look like they're next to each other and not one behind each other, because you've had to paint all this around this object, and then that doesn't look natural. So that's why we always start with the background and then we work our way forward. That way when you're coming and you're painting the front object, you're automatically overlapping, and then you get that natural one in front of the other effect that you need to make your painting look natural and realistic. So obviously for this guy, let's do a quick little planning. Before I do any artwork, I always do just that little bit of planning so that I know in what order am I going to paint things. And that allows me to, in my head, know what's coming next. And you'll find that your painting just flows a lot easier when you do that. So with this guy over here, we're going to obviously paint our background. Then there is only one more object, right? But inside this one object, the bird, there's different layers. So we have to paint those layers in the order. So take a look. This wing over here is overlapped by the neck and the chest. So we're going to paint him. Then here on the face, you're going to paint that first because these hairs overlap here. Then you're going to paint, as far as these guys here are concerned, you're going to paint these back guys first and then bring these guys overlapping them afterwards. Can you see that? The orange overlaps the blue. So I'm going to paint the blue and then the orange. Paint all this blue and then the orange, because everywhere all this orange overlaps the blue. So in other words, it's 1, 2, 3, actually 1, 2, 3, because you see the green is overlapping the blue again. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then lastly, yeah, this little wing, piece of the wing over there, he overlaps the orange again. So he comes in front. So there's our order that we need to paint everything in. Then, when it comes to the backgrounds, I like to simplify my backgrounds. So we're actually very lucky with this scene, because the background has already been simplified because it's out of focus. And that's usually what I do. I push my backgrounds out of focus so that they don't compete with the focal point. Because you always want whatever you're painting. For example, in this painting, we're painting the parrot, right? So we want the parrot to be the star of the painting. So everything else in the painting must complement but not compete with the focal point. So here all we do is we're going to take our background and we push it out of focus, which luckily it already is. But when you're painting something like a landscape, then it's not. So what you have to do then is you're going to take all the other stuff that are in focus and push them out of focus. So for example, if you've got a house, you've decided a house in a meadow, and you've now decided, okay, I want this house to be the start of my painting. So then you're going to take the house and you're going to put it in lovely, beautiful, sharp detail and so on. And everything else, you're going to gradually push out of focus. And that way you know, well, all the attention always goes towards your house. So with this guy, we're going to do the background out of focus. And we'll just put in a few random colors. But now we need to go and mix those colors. So I think let's pop the reference photo down in the corner and then let's get some colors going. So what I usually do is I'll take a look and see which colors have I already got in my box of paints. So I'm seeing like sap green over there, and I'm definitely seeing some like cadmium yellows. And then there's some really darker colors as well. So we need to possibly darken that up with maybe some raw umber, or we add some French ultramarine to the sap green. We'll take a look from there. So I think we do need to just be careful that we don't have our background competing with the bird. So for example, this yellow over here, we don't want this to be too close to that. Otherwise, these guys are going to compete for attention. We want to push this background way out into the distance. So I think in this case, the easiest way of making sure that our bird stays nice in the foreground and nice and vibrant is to actually tone these colors down and let's make them darker so that we've got this lovely dark contrast against these lovely bright vibrant colors in the foreground. So we'll use our artist license a little bit to adjust those colors. So I think let's start off with the sap green. We'll put a reasonable amount down because we've got actually quite a bit of background to paint. So I'm going to put down just a little bit of the cadmium yellow as well. So this is the Georgian water mixable oil paints from Daler-Rowney. Because the background is quite large, what we want is to be able to block in this entire area reasonably quick. So what I am going to do is just mix in a few drops of water into the paint. So let's take all the sap green, and we just add just 3 or 4 drops of water. Because straight out the tube, the paint is great for regular painting, but now we want to have a bit more coverage over a larger area. So we add a little bit more water to it. So now remember from our initial intro class in part 1, we know that the color is going to now slightly lighten up for a short period while the paint and the water are mixing together, the oil and the water, while they're doing their thing. So there we go, my color's already back to normal, so remember that's normal. Okay, so I've made sure I've got myself a nice creamy consistency, but the paint isn't runny wet. Can you see that? It's not really gonna drip off the it's not dripping off the knife or anything like that. It's not runny. It's just a nice creamy consistency. So now I want to show you an interesting thing of how I've laid out all my paints and my brushes and so on. In other words, what I've done to keep myself organized. So I've packed all my paints down there nice and neat from according to the color wheel, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. And here I've got some bigger tubes, and then I've got my browns over there as well separately. Technically you could put your browns over there next to the blues, because that's where they belong. Then, notice that I've got 2 containers for water. I've got a big one here in which I'm going to wash my brushes whenever necessary. I've got a smaller container and a dropper, which I use to decant my water. And that water is for when I'm thinning down my paints, when I'm adjusting its consistency, in other words. That way I know I've always got clean water which I'm adding to my paints, and I'm not getting contamination from the dirty water, because obviously initially when you use that it would be fine, but as you go along with your painting, that water is going to get dirtier and dirtier and dirtier. So as you eventually you're mixing in dirtier and dirtier paints water into your paint, and you don't want that. So that's what I do to keep my paints nice and vibrant. And then by arranging all my paints in their order, it's always easy to find them. I never have to look for a paint. I always know where it is. So as I pick it up and I use it and I put it back down again, I put it back down in that same place. And then to the left of the paints, I have all my brushes laid out, all my favorite brushes. Okay, so for this one, got a nice big area to cover. So I'm going to use a number 8 Robert Simmons flat bristle brush. Okay, then before we start, what I have done to transfer this onto my canvas is I've used dressmaker's carbon paper. So let me show you how dressmaker's carbon paper works. It works just like regular pen carbon paper that you use around the office, except the dressmaker's carbon paper comes in different colors. See that? I've got yellow, I've got blue, I've got green, and I've got white. So what's cool and awesome about that is I can now use the correct color carbon paper at the correct place. So for example, this guy over here, I've got sort of greens in that area, and here I've got lots of yellows and so on. So what I've actually done is I've used the yellow carbon paper to do all my line work. So at the end of the day, I don't think you're going to be able to see it. The video is not going to pick up the yellow and the white so nicely. But in the end of the day, I have yellow lines all the way around here. So that if at any stage my lines do shine through in the final artwork, they are roughly the same colors as around in the artwork. So you don't notice them. They tend to just blend away. Where, for example, if I'd used a blue pen carbon here inside these orangey bits and so on, or the white of the face, if the pen carbon was shining through over there, then I would have ended up having all these blue marks that just don't belong, and then you have to paint over them a few times to get rid of them. So by using the dressmaker's carbon paper, saves me all the hassle. And then what I have drawn is just the basic outlines all the way around the main features, around the beak, and around the eye, and around the main wing, and the edges of the face, and so on. And then wherever I've seen major details, so like here, I've got some really nice big feathers that end over there, so I've drawn them in. And then like here, I've given myself just a few little lines just to get a feel for the different directions of these feathers. They're the hairs on each feather go in a general direction. Here they go in this direction, here they're going in this direction, here they're going in that direction, here they're going straight down, and so on. So I've just added those few little direction lines in so that as I'm painting, it reminds me of which direction to paint. Then obviously here with the eye, you need to get that detail around the eye really accurate, because that's your focal point. If you're looking at somebody, you always look at them in the eye. So the same thing would happen when you're looking at a parrot or any other animal. You're also going to look at them in the eye. That's just naturally the way where we look. So that becomes the focal point in the focal point. All right. So I'll peel that back. So I do stick it down with masking tape. So that way I can at any stage, so it's formed a hinge there because there's two, you see that? So I can at any stage flip this guy back if I need to check any type of detail. And then I've got a printout, a smaller printout, it's also in your handout, which I then use as an actual reference while I'm painting. So you can use this, or you can just work off the photograph on your computer screen. So I'm just going to pick up some of the paint. And just with a crisscrossing motion, because your canvas itself has got a weave to it. So by using a crisscrossing motion to put the paint down, you get into the entire weave of the canvas. I'm going to do this. Now, as you get around here to the edge, just carefully work right up to your line that you've made. So the interesting thing is that the sap green is actually a bit of a transparent color. So as you put this guy down, you'll find that he doesn't cover the canvas perfectly, which I think is actually quite great. Can you see that? Just because you've got thicker and thinner paint areas, automatically you're getting a bit of a foliage effect. It looks like leaves and bushes in the background. Here by the feathers, when you get to this edge over here, don't be shy, rather go into the feather area than staying too far, because remember we've got all these feathers overlapping over there. Can you see they overlap, and you've got a little bit of feather and a little bit of background in between? So don't be shy, we feel free to cut into the back of the feathers. But here by the beak and stuff, there we obviously need to work really accurate. So the paint's going on beautifully smooth. So I'm really happy with that. Getting good coverage too. As good a coverage as what you would normally get with a sap green if you were using traditional paints, traditional oil paint. Now if you're working and it's a really hot day, you find that the water will now evaporate. So as you paint, if you're painting a large area like we are now, you may find that you'll need to just add some extra water back into your paint to get the consistency back to where it needs to be, because obviously as that water evaporates, the paint will thicken up. So now notice, to get a nice sharp edge over here, I'm not painting like this all the way along there, because then what happens is these bristles can spread the left to right. So it's very difficult to get a nice accurate edge. But if I paint like this all the way along that edge over there, your bristles can't get longer and shorter, right? So that's the way I get a nice, perfect, accurate edging over there. I know a lot of my students say, but they shake, so that's pointless. So if you do shake, then rather use a smaller brush. What I do as well, just to keep my hand steady, is notice what I'm doing with my pinky. I'm laying my pinky down on the canvas. And you can, in this case, because we've still got empty canvas over there, I can actually lay my entire hand down on the canvas to keep it steady, so that in the end of the day I'm not trying to paint with my arm or my hand, I'm painting by moving my fingers. So my hand itself is steady, there's no movement in my hand. I think you'll agree with me, you can do finer movements with your fingers than what you can with your hand or by moving your entire arm, because you've got small little muscles that are doing the moving. If you're moving your arm and so on, there's big muscles doing the work, doing the heavy lifting. So in our previous class, we had a nice discussion about the fat over lean principle, where you need to have layers of paint, subsequent layers of paint must have more oil in it than previous layers to avoid cracking. So now today we're painting alla prima, which means everything is in, we're going to be painting everything in one go. So that means that we are basically only painting one layer of paint. Because that all the paint we're painting now is going to be, as far as being on the canvas concerned, exactly the same age. So all the paint is going to be exposed to the elements or the air for the same amount of time, which means it's all going to dry at the same time. Let me just quickly do this fine detail over here. Feel free to go over to a smaller brush when you've got little sharp corners like that to do. So I'm a man, I can only do one thing at a time, so I can't think and work very accurate over there and still talk at the same time. So so yes, we're going to be adjusting the consistency of the paint in order to get the one layer, or the one, yeah, I suppose you can call it the one layer of paint to lie on top of the previous. But once all the paint is down on the canvas and this painting is finished, this, all those different layers that we painted are going to dry at the same time, because they're all going to be exposed to the air for the same amount of time. So we're never going to have to use any oil today. We'll only use water. So for today's painting, you're going to pack your Georgian water mixable oil away. It's not necessary. We'll only use water. Alrighty, we can already see our bird. Look at that. That shows you how important negative painting can be. Your background is as important as the foreground, because look at that. Your background also helps you define the foreground. Okay, so I'll pop that over there. I'm going to quickly finish this piece of over here. Now, the canvas I'm working on is a box canvas. It's the stretched canvas and the wood frame. So when you're working on a wood framed canvas like that, what you want to do is paint around the edges. And that way you give the customer the opportunity to either hang it as it is or frame it. Okay, so you can see I've just done a really basic blocking. So problem number one is that I've painted all the way around this edge over here. So look what happened. We've got this kind of a situation. We've got our foreground and we've now painted the background around it. So these lines here are physically going around the bird, which in real life, obviously they're not, because they're two separate items. The background is way at the back and it's doing its own thing. So we've got to make sure that none of these lines are going around, looks like it's going around the bird. So you've got to change all these directions up. So to do that, let's take this, your brush, and just give it a wash. So it's clean and clean again. Then just dry it off on a scrap piece of t-shirting. So I just use a scrap cloth. So this is an old t-shirt. Then all we're going to do, because remember all this paint is wet, so all we're going to do is just move this paint around and change the direction. But now because your brush is feed, it's actually picking up some of the paint. See that? It's gradually loading itself up with the paint that's on the canvas. So when you first start off, it's going to give you a lighter area. And now as I continue with this, I change these directions. Any direction lines that I see. More and more paint is loading up into this brush. So it's not making the paint that's there, it's not picking up the paint. And that leaves that paint in that area, it leaves it the same darkness. So that means we're getting lighter patches where we're lifting up new paint, existing paint. And here we're just moving paint around, so there's no change in color or tonal value. So every now and again, I'm going to take this brush here and I'm going to wash him. To get rid of all that excess paint that's in there now. And dry him off again. And then I'll continue. I'm still using just really random marks and shapes and crisscrosses and so on. Not really looking for any patterns in the background. More like just a smoky effect. No kind of a pattern. Everything must be really rough and random. Okay, let's start maybe over here instead of against the bird for a change. Okay, and here we'll be lifting stuff out further away from the bird, and as we come closer to the bird, things stay dark. And then over here too. Okay, so I'm going looking all the way around and see, are there any little lines that are going following the path that we did to outline the bird. And I'm making sure that I'm not seeing any little lines. Any lines I see, I'm breaking up. I'm making sure that they all little random crisscrosses. We don't want a halo around our bird. Okay, so now already we've got different tonal value changes. We haven't even used a second color. So that's fantastic. And you'll often find that that's enough. But what the heck, we've already put some cadmium yellow down, so let's use it. So I'm going to take my a roll of kitchen towel and I'm going to just clean my knife. Now I'm quite stingy, I don't like to waste paint, so I'm going to take this and I'm going to scoop it up. I'm going to put that back down on the palette. Can you see how much paint I've saved by doing that? So I'm done with this now, but I'm not sure whether I'm going to need it again. So I don't throw that paint away. I'm going to scoop it up and I'm going to pop it here on the one side. And that way, if I ever need any of my sap green again at any stage, maybe I missed a little piece, or I want to work in a little jagged edge or something like that, then I've got paint. Alright, so that there is now dirty, but I'm not going to bother cleaning it because we're going to be working this into the sap green anyway. So let's take some of that and bring it down. So that's another thing you'll also notice. I put all my paints up at the top and then I bring them down to mix. And that's why I keep all my paints at the top nice and clean and neat. Well, then we're going to use that little trick I showed you last in the previous class, how you can put your paints back in the tube. Right, so let's get some. You see, I haven't really bothered getting the knife too clean either. It's more or less So instantly that yellow has married with a little bit of green that's there. So the minute I put it down on the canvas, it's going to look natural. Alright, so you can see that's still really bright. So we're not going to take too much, we'll just pick a little bit of it up at a time. And we'll work it into the canvas. It's easy for us to add more paint, but it's very difficult to take paint off. So now you can use, you can see over here, there's a bit of greenery going on over there. There's quite a bit of greenery and yellows going on over here. You can use that as a guide, but don't try and get it exact. Remember, if you the bird moves, then he's going to be, you're going to be looking at him from a different angle. The wind's going to blow, and then these leaves or branches or whatever that are there are going to move to here or to there. So don't try and get it exact, but just use it as a rough little guide. Now, using the same crisscrosses, you work in some of the yellow. And now, because you picked up only a little bit of paint, you're soon going to notice what kind of a difference is this making. Is it making a big difference? Or is it so little difference that you can barely see the paint? Or see the color change? That'll tell you then afterwards, in subsequent pickups, when you pick up paint for subsequent times to work in, how much paint to pick up? Do I just need to pick up a little bit of paint, or do I need to pick up a nice decent dollop to work it in? So for now, I'm having to pick up a reasonable amount of paint, and I'm working it in still with the crisscrosses, making really sure that I've got creating a random shape. I don't want that to form all sorts of funny patterns or distinct patterns, like maybe a bunch of lines running down like this, repetitive lines and things. And B, I'm making sure that it's not forming a new outline around the bird. So what I'll often do in a case like this, is because I want the background to make it look as though it's going past the objects in the foreground, I'll draw myself a line like that. So let's say, for example, we've got this over here, and I'm going to gently bring it up to the edge, not forming a halo. And then I'm going to follow that imaginary line to there. I'm going to do the same thing over here. I'm going to continue this little shape or path. Being really careful to make sure that I'm not forming any kind of a halo. All sorts of different directions and crisscrosses. But now you see what's happening. Now your background is going past and behind the bird. Nice lovely rough little crisscrossy strokes over there. Now I'm going to just gently work it in. I want all this to be out of focus. And the way you get things, make them look as though they're out of focus, is you get rid of all the hard edges. You don't want any hard lines and things. Okay, and let's maybe put something running down over here. So let's dump the photograph, because now we've got to a point where we're pretty much doing our own thing, eh? So we've got that. Maybe this comes up like this. Yeah, that's fine. And let's maybe take something over here. Maybe there's a smaller plant over there or something like that. Yeah, that should be cool. And we've got a nice little bit of variety. So now again, I'm looking for halos, outlines around the bird. And can you see this line is now exactly parallel to the back of the bird? So I need to break it. add some extra paint in there just to get a different shape. Alright, so I think that's going to give us, it's still nice and dark, but it's going to give us a nice effect for the bird. Nice framing there. Put him in the garden and not inside a cage or in the pet shop or whatever, inside the house. And I think we've got enough darks with us using thicker and thinner paint. I think we've got enough variety in the greens to not to have to add an extra darker green in there. So by doing that has saved us some color mixing and some paint. Okay, so as before, that there is sort of just a mix which we're done with. I can throw that away. But this paint over here is still pretty much our original mixed color. So if we ever need some of that, I'm going to put him one side and save him. If you have an extra palette, then you can actually take this, because this is now part of the background and we now need to start working on the bird. So these sort of just taking up space at this point. So if you've got a second palette, feel free to take them and pop them on a different palette. And that will allow you to then clean this palette completely and start afresh. So I think that's what I'm going to do. I've got a second palette here. It's always good to have at least two palettes. So by the way, what I'm using for a palette is just a regular tile, a bathroom tile. So you go down to your local tiling guy and you say, listen, I'm thinking of tiling my bathroom white, but I'm not sure if the color is going to match the white of the bath. So can I have a sample tile to check? And that's how you get yourself a free tile. Alrighty, so let's clean that guy out. So I'm just going to pop down a little bit of water. So you see I'm using my dirty water, not my clean water. Piece of kitchen towel. So don't put down too little water, put down enough. Because what you want to do is you want to dilute the paint that's there. So you're not trying to clean up or mop up or anything like that. All we're doing with this is just diluting the paint that's there. Then I take my whole roll of kitchen towel and I just mop up the water that's there. As we said before, we are now going to start with the face. So the big thing that we need to look out for the face is we're going to do the white first, and then we'll add the little black detailing in. Inside this white, if you look carefully, you'll see it's not just flat white. There's shape to the face. For example, let's take a look at this area over here. Can notice in between the black, it's gone dark over there because you've got a curling effect like that. Let me demonstrate it with a piece of paper. It's curling like that. So you can see the top is lighter than the bottom because the sun is coming from the top. Can you see that? Flat gives you one color. Curved gives you a change in tonal value. And that's what's happening here. It's lighter at the top, and as it curls in and underneath, it goes darker over there. And the same thing is happening over here. So it sort of goes bump, bump. And obviously the skin is now a little bit wrinkly, so we'll have to give it that effect. And then here we've got the nostril. So what's funny about the nostril is you've got a looking in effect. Can you see how dark it is there inside the nostril? So we'll make it really dark inside the nostril and then just quickly fade it out, and that's going to give us that that nostril effect over there. So let's go and take a look. So I have replaced my water as well, the water that I wash my brushes with. Because we're going to be working with such beautiful, vibrant greens and blues and yellows and oranges and stuff, I didn't want all the dirty greens from the background to have any chance of contaminating my vibrant colors inside the bird. Alright, so let's do that. And then to mix up just a really quick neutral gray, let's take a little bit of raw umber. And a little bit of French ultramarine. So you can see I'm not using a lot, I'm using both colors, roughly 50-50. I'll mix them together. And I find that gives me just a nice little neutral gray. A good mix of your three primary colors. Because the brown has got orange in it, which is red and yellow. And then you're obviously now you're adding blue, more blue. So the way I test it is I pull it out like that, and I can see if I've got a nice neutral gray. If it's too brown, then I add more blue. If it's too blue, then I add more brown. If it's too blue, then I add more brown. But there we go. I was lucky today. It's given me a beautiful, perfect in-between nice little neutral gray there. Can you see there? Beautiful. So if you ever need to mix up a quick little neutral gray, there you have it. That's how you do it. So I think what we'll do is we'll block in that entire face area there with a white-ish mix. So it does seem to be slightly off-white. I think it all just depends, because it's being white, it all depends on how the light falls on it. But just to give it a little bit of color and interest, I think what we can do is just add the tiniest touch of yellow ochre in there. And the reason I'm doing that is so that if I need to highlight this guy, then it's because I've added the bit of yellow ochre in it, this is now off-white. So that allows me to use pure white to add a highlight. So that's the method behind the madness. But now I can't add so much of this that it becomes yellow. It's still going to appear white when you look at it. So when I pick this paint up, I'm going to spread it out on the knife like this. So that I have literally, can you see there, the zero height on the amount of paint that's on that knife. It's literally just a smidgen, and I'm going to work it in here. So I'm now mixing on a white palette, so it's easy for me to compare. I can compare the white of the palette with that paint over there to see how much of a difference in color have I got. I'm going to do a little bit more, just a tiny touch more. If you find that you've added too much of your yellow in it, then scoop half of it away and put it one side, and then bring some more white in it. You can always use that mix over there for anything else, because remember there is so little in it. Alright, fantastic. You see there? I've got a definite little change in color. So if I ever had to come back and highlight, I can use neat white, and it will stand out against this. Yet, if you look at that on its own, can you see it still appears white? It doesn't look yellow. That's fantastic. Alright, so we're going to take this and we're going to block in the entire face area. So just to make sure that it spreads nice and evenly, I'm going to add just a tiny touch of water in there, 2 to 3 drops, just to get it nice and a nice flame consistency, but we don't want much. We're correcting the consistency, we're not trying to make it watery or anything. Just a lovely creamy mayonnaise kind of consistency. Alright, so I'm going to stick with a bristle brush because we want to get coverage now. We don't need a soft head brush. And let's block everything in. So you'll find that it may be a little bit difficult to see where you've blocked in. So what you do is you sit to the side, so that the paint is actually reflecting, the sun is reflecting off the paint. And that's how you're going to see where you have painted already. And then just for what the heck, I am going to avoid the eye itself. Because we have to paint him completely, separately. He's going to have his own little shadings and things. He's not part of the skin on the face. But rather go over to a smaller brush here on the edges. And that way you can make sure that you don't go over the edge. And you can also, when you are edging it here on the inside of the face, you can go slightly over your lines. Because you do have that overlap where the feathers start coming out of the grow out of the skin. Alright, so for us to now get that curling effect like this, we've got to go and adjust this color. So I'm going to take some of this. We're not going to need lots of paint, just a little bit of that, and a tiny touch of our neutral gray. So again, you see like I did over there, just pull up a little bit of paint and add that to you. And first see what does it do. Not quite enough yet, pick up a little bit more. So what I do is, as I go along, I'm obviously working off my computer screen to get the right colors. But what I'm basically doing is I'm taking my knife and I'm holding it over the correct place on the screen. So I'm comparing that color that's over there with the color that I've got on my knife by holding these two together like that. So when you do that, just make sure that your knife isn't reflecting light and stuff like it is there like that. Because then you're not seeing the true color on the knife. So just twist and tilt your knife until it's not shining anymore. You get a true picture of what you're seeing. And that'll quickly tell you if you've got the right tonal value. At this stage, we're not too concerned if it's not the right color. But that doesn't matter. If you're really working for a super realistic image, then no problem. Then what you can do is you can go ahead and adjust the color as well. But for this exercise, a neutral gray like this will do just fine. So I've nearly got the correct tonal value here on my side. How's yours coming along? Great. Yes, and obviously we can't use a large brush. I'm just going to use a smaller bristle brush. Load it up with paint. Now all we're looking for is this area here below the eye, over there, and that area over there, just to get that basic little curling in effect first. So that is roughly around that area over there. I know it's a little bit difficult for you to see what's going on in the painting at the moment, but as these tonal values come in, things will gradually start making sense. Okay, so as this guy curls away from the light like that, it gets darker and darker. Let's get a piece of paper again and demonstrate that. As I curl this guy, Can you see at the bottom is the darkest? Because he's pointing the most away from the light. So the bottom over here needs to be darker, and then he goes lighter towards the top. So you start by putting your paint down there at the bottom, and then you work your way up. And as you work your way up, see what's happening? It's mixing with the white that we already have there. And just like that, you've got that curl and that shading that you need. Okay, this guy over here, he's a little bit different. He fades away to the bottom, and to the top, and to that side, and to that side. So let's first take a look. Does it curl away to the bottom quickly or slowly? If it curls away, fades away slowly, then we need to fade this line at the bottom away quickly. So I'm just going to gently rub over it until that actual line where the two white and the gray meet disappears. Okay, let's do the same thing at the top. The top, it also seems to disappear quite quickly. So again, we just keep blending over it like that until the line disappears. Alright, let's take a look. How does he disappear over there? There he seems to disappear sort of just past the eye. So I'm going to gently just pull that paint out until it disappears on me. And on this side around that eye like that, it also gradually just disappears. Over the same place all the time until I'm happy with my shading. Okay, and now here where the hair starts, there's also a few places because the hair itself casts a little shadow in this area over here. So I'm going to add a little bit of a shadow there while we add it. Bit of proactive painting over here as well. There's quite a prominent little shadow over there, so let's not fade him in. We'll just gently tap it soft to soften the edge. Gently tap. There we go. So we've got a hard edge at the top and a soft edge here at the bottom. Okay, so here we've got our nose coming down over there, so here's also a little bit of a shadow. So I'm going to just tease in a touch of paint over there. Let's pick some more up. Over here by the mouth, you've got this bottom beak and the top beak. Where they meet, they form a little bit of a fold over there. That fold seems to cool down there like that and disappear. Alrighty, over there by the nose, let's see, let's pick up some more of this grey. We've got the nostril itself, so for now I'm just going to pop a marker down there just so that I can get a feel for where that nostril needs to be. But then there's also a little shading over there. So needless to say, that nostril does need to go darker, but for now, at least I've got a feel for its positioning. Yeah, that's good enough. Alright, so now let's pick up some of that original black that we mixed, that neutral black. I think let's even give our brush a nice wash. So that the black that we put down is a nice, neat black. We want it as dark as possible. Because it's that darkness that's going to give us the looking in effect. Let's see. Yeah, it's somewhere around there like that. Alrighty, so while I've got a little bit of this black on my brush, I feel we can go a little bit darker over there, so I'm going to bring just a little bit more of this. Black in at the bottom, and we'll just fade it up. And that really just accentuates that curling in, and there's less light over there. I think that for now, probably good enough. Possibly go a little bit darker on this area over here as well. I don't want to sweat the small stuff so soon. Once we've got more detail in, then it's easier to judge whether you've got things light enough or dark enough and so on. Right now, can you see there's all these funny little folds and things? Let's bring our picture back. It's real wrinkly. Alright, so to get that wrinkly effect, let's go back to the palette. So I'm going to take some of this. I'm going to add just a little bit of yellow ochre into it. Maybe let's maybe make it a bit darker as well. So what I'm looking for when I'm testing this, to see whether I've got the tonal value correct, whether it's dark enough or not. I'm looking to find the darkest sort of fold, which seems to be around there, and I'm holding this up. Now obviously I'm showing you on a printout, but I'm actually looking on the screen. To get the tonal value correct. Tiny touch of yellow ochre in this thing, as I've added more black in it, just to keep that little bit of a yellow ochre effect in it. So it's not pure black, it's got just a touch of warmth to it. Just to keep that off-white effect that we've started with. Alright, now we'll just use basically a fine liner. So just get one or two drops of water in there. Because now what's happening is now we're going to paint wet paint over wet paint. So the next layer of paint needs to be a little bit wetter than the previous layer. Just so that this paint will lie on the previous layer of paint. Okay, so we'll roll our brush in this paint. So the idea now is that we're not going to press hard. We're going to be pressing really, really gentle to get these little wrinkles in. Alrighty, so I can see there's lots of wrinkles in this area over here. So we'll start in here. So what's important now is that you look at the direction of these wrinkles. And then we're just going to gently scribble them in. So they are harder and more pronounced over here, which means we always start in this area over here to get them deeper and darker over here. And then as you've got less paint on the brush, you gradually move upwards. So I'm obviously now following these directions and things. funny little crisscrossy effect. So as we go up here, they become less and less prominent and less easy to see. So as a result, I've got less and less paint on my brush. So now just try and judge these little angles and things as best you can. It's really not necessary to get an exact replica. You don't want each wrinkle in the exact same place. That's not the idea. I would say similar to your own fingerprints, the wrinkles on this is going to be different on each bird. Okay, let's zoom out and complete the rest. So now just take a look on your reference photo and just keep checking. Where are these marks? Concentrate on getting the tonal values correct and the directions. As you can see here around the eye, these little wrinkles are following the roundness of the eye. Like that, and then over here they gradually curl towards the back again. In other words, all these little wrinkles and things are now following the shape or the contour of the face. If you don't get these things 100%, don't worry too much. Remember, we do still need to put all these little black lines over, which is going to sort of sink them in and hide them a little bit. Alrighty, so that's good enough. So I think we may as well just tackle the eye while we're at it. Because it seems like it's got the same colors. Can you see that? Here on the outside we've got a little bit more the same color we used for the skin, but it's got a little bit more yellow ochre in it. So I'm just going to steal a little bit of the skin color using my fine round brush, bring a little bit of yellow ochre, a little bit more yellow ochre in there, until I'm happy I've got more or less the correct color. So I don't need a full drop of water in there, so I'll put a drop of water down there, dip my brush in it, and then work it in from there like that. So I've only got a tiny amount of paint, there's literally the thinnest little layer. Can you see that? Tiny, tiny amount. Pop that in here around the outside and see if it's okay. Seems good. That color around there, and then a little bit of this same color that we've been using for the stripes. So I'm just picking up a little bit of that. That area over there. Now I'm going to pick up just some of the original skin color Bravia in between those two guys. I'll gently blend them in. Okay, let's wash the brush. And I will pick up some of the black. Pop it in for the pupil. So you need to now be careful when you do this. You want a nice, perfect little oval. Close to a perfect oval is what you can get it. Okay, now I'm going to take some of the wrinkle color and darken it with some more black in it. And a little bit more yellow ochre in it. So it's really just the tiniest amount of paint that I'm mixing, just enough to load the brush. Because over here we've got this cast shadow over there. The thickness of the skin over there is casting a shadow on the eye over here. So we've got a nice sharp line, and then that sharp line fades away to the inside of the eye. Gently brush that line that gets formed there on the inside. Just gently brush it away so that it becomes a shading. Alright, so it seems like we can take a little bit more of the wrinkle color and just darken up over here a bit more. Shadow there a little bit more. Yeah, that should give us a nice little distance over there. Okay, let's wash the brush. So what happens with the eye is you get a reflection from the sun. So I'm going to take some neat white. So wash your brush, just take some neat white. Send it down with a touch of water. Because what we're going to do now is we're going to add that reflection in, but we need the paint to be nice and thin so that don't have to press to get it off the brush. As you put it down, it must just flow off the brush. You can make it thin to the consistency of an ink. Let's put that little reflection in there like that. So always make that reflection overlap the pupil to get maximum contrast. Let's lighten it up a little bit more. Just adding a little bit more paint down there. Remember, this paint is now really thin, so I just touch down there and it just adds an extra bit of thickness. Great, so now what we can do is we can add in all the black as well. So I'm going to use just some neat black. So I have washed the brush. here, all around here, we've got this little bit of a dotted effect. So I'm just going to tap around there, every now and again, just cleaning everything up. By tapping like this, what it's doing is it's giving you that little roughness on the edge. So just clean your brush every now and again to make sure that it's not mixing with the paint underneath, and you're putting down a nice solid black. It's not gradually becoming grayer and grayer. So you can see what I'm doing is I'm also just turning the brush in my hand to make sure that I'm not getting just one pattern, it's getting a random pattern all the way around. There, okay, so let's go back to a wrinkle color. This looks like we've got a lovely little wrinkle at the bottom here that we've missed. There's a guy over here. Yeah, seems to be running around there somewhere, eh? Just wash my brush. I've gone a little bit too far there. So if you've done the same, don't worry about it. Just wash the brush. Go back to your skin color. And just work it in there. And wipe the brush clean. Lift out any excess. Simple as that. Neat little wrinkle over there that we can put in, why not? And what the heck, let's make this here a little bit darker as well. So wash your brush, make sure that it's nice and clean, don't have any white on it or any light color. Some of the neat black. And now it's quite simple really. Just take a look and see where are all these little black marks, and just paint them in. So what is important with these black lines is that you get their directions as close as what you can. You can see they're really rough little lines. So you can put them in almost in like a bit of a stabbing motion. And if you see your brush has now become because as you're putting this down, it mixes with the black and it mixes with the skin color you had originally. So if you see that the paint that you're putting down is now not nice and black anymore, then go ahead and wash your brush. So when I'm doing something like this, I'm first going to just put down a few prominent guys. They may not even be perfect, but just rough, just so that I can plot out where everything needs to be. Because once you've got the prominent guys in, then it's easier to judge the position of all the other ones. So can you see I'm putting them in just like little stripes? And are they turning out identical? No, of course not. Each bird's unique. So a lot of my marks that I'm putting down are also going to end up being different and unique. And now you can see that these marks also just following the contour. So once you've got that initial right, it becomes easier to just pop your own, do your own thing. I'm putting decent amounts of paint down at places. Now that we've got those blacks in, now we can see that some of these little darks over here aren't quite dark enough. These little wrinkles. So now we can go ahead and be a little bit more bold and pop them in and make them darker. Most of them seem okay though. Yeah, that's great. Okay, so while we've got the black and everything on the palette, we may as well do the beak as well, then that's done. As I'm blocking this in, I'm trying to get as little paint on the canvas as possible. I don't want to plaster the paint on. I'm putting down just enough paint to cover that white of the canvas. I can always add more paint. But if I add too much, it becomes difficult to mix other colors inside that paint that's there, because there's just so much that it overpowers whatever color that you're adding. And you end up having to add heaps of the other color, and then your paint just goes thicker and thicker and thicker, and eventually you just simply can't mix anymore. Alright, so that little tip of the beak, I'm not going to bother with that. We'll have to do that with a finer, sharper brush. Now I'm going to block in the second beak, but now look what I do to make sure that I don't lose that line between the two over there. I'm going to put this guy down and I'm going to leave just a hair width between the two, just enough for me to see. Eventually we'll bring these two colors closer and closer until eventually we know the correct colors, until eventually we've got the correct colors, and then we'll be able to see the split where the two meet. So again, I'm not going to try and go all the way perfectly to the edge, because that edge may be a different color. Just blocking in the worst of the worst, making sure there's no excess paint over here. Just a nice, thin, even coverage is all we need. OK, Okay, so I'm going to wash the brush now, but I'm going to still stick with this little, with the small bristle brush. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use that color over there, the one that we used for the wrinkles. Now let's take a look. But now we have to do one beak at a time. Let's do this guy over here. So let's zoom in on him. Okay, so before we actually go ahead and start painting, let's at least just plan our angle of attack and see what is going on with this beak. What do we actually need to do to make this beak look correct? So the first thing we need to realize is it's flat over here, but then it curls around away from us here at the front. And that's why you can clearly see that there's a change of color or tonal value over there, because it's because of that curling away effect. Remember, let's grab our piece of paper. It's lighter closer to the sun and darker away from the sun. But that's why it's lighter over here, darker over there, as it cools away from the light. Then we've got the skin over here is casting a shadow on the beak. This beak is sort of seems to be folding inside the bottom one, so there's also got a bit of a shadow over there. Then obviously this beak is almost like, it's like your nail. It's made up of thin little layers. So that's why we've got this, all this other funny little textures. But we're not worrying about the textures, we're worrying about the shape. That's the most important. So let's pick up some of this wrinkle color of ours. And let's first work on getting these shape right. So we know it needs to go lighter on this edge over here. So we'll add that lighter edge in over there. So now all I'm interested in at this point is just getting that, basically that tonal value correct. Which seems pretty close, pretty close. If anything, it's ever so slightly darker than on the photo. That's good enough for now. Alright, now we need to take a look. What does it do? How far does that shading go in? Does that shading end over here? Does the shading end right there? Or somewhere in between? So it seems to be pretty close to what we've already got there. So all we can do is just get rid of the worst paint off the brush. Wipe it on your kitchen towel like that. Just to get rid of the excess. Because we don't need to introduce any new paint. Otherwise that shading would end, will end up over there. Because we've got to get rid of all that paint. So just using a dry clean brush, I'm going to go over this edge. So just rubbing it like that. Can you see what happens? Now that you've got rid of that sharp edge, it's given you a shading. So if I check it out, it's just a little bit short still. We can shade it out a little bit slower. So I'm going to have to pick up a little bit more paint. Add a bit more down here. A little bit broader this time. Clean the worst off the brush. And just move the paint that's there around. So now as you're shading like this, if you do find that the one paint is overpowering the other, so let's say for example there's now suddenly too much white, then just pick up some black on your brush and then continue from there. But I think we're okay. That seems to be a good little curve over there. If I just do that to get rid of the, like that, seems to be a nice little curve, so I'm happy with that. Now we need to get all this funny little textures and stuff in the center. So I'm going to just use the same paint. And we're just going to work in a few little wiggles and squiggles and things for now. All we're trying to do is just get rid of the plain solid color of the black. Okay, so that big does seem to be quite lighter towards the tip over there, so we can bring that guy in. Right. That's just these funny little angles and things. Really not interested in trying to get any kind of replica of that effect there. I don't think it's necessary. Just like that. Okay, now you'll see what I'm doing is I'm avoiding that area over there and I'm avoiding that area over there to get those two little shadows right. So let's see over here, we've got some lighter bits. Marks and goodies, there's even some marks over here too, so break all that little line up over there. Just funny little dabs and dashes and things. Yeah, I think that's good enough. Alright, so let's take a look. That little tip over there is lighter. So I'm actually going to just pick up a little bit of white, but without cleaning the brush. So I've got a lighter gray. We could even maybe use the lighter gray that we've got on the palette. So that goes over there. Also just one or two little stripes. Can you see there are one or two little places that are not, it's not smooth. One or two little lighter texture spots. Same thing around here as well. So I'm just using that original little off-white gray that we had. And roughly where I see these grays, I'm just popping them in. A few little random dabs, dashes and dots. Just adding texture, that's all. Just darkened up that tiny little touch over there because there was a white spot. The canvas still shining through, which I've just darkened up. Yeah, that's all great. So there's now just one little bit of detail that I still see as well. So I'm going to pick up that original gray, the one that we've been using to lighten up over there. And here I'm seeing just a little line doing that. Alright, so it's back to our original grey again, the bigger brush, because we've got the same thing happening over here. We've got a quick little bit of a shading going on over here, so we'll pop that in, fade him downwards. Upwards really quickly. And then at the top over here it seems to be lighter, and then we've also got this little texture, same as what we had over there. Texture going on over there. I mean, there's light on that edge. There's another funny little lighter mark going down over there like that. And here's a few little funny dabs and dashes running down over here. So that's just breaking that smoothness. I can see a lovely little white edge over there. So I'm going to pick up some of our lightest grey. And let's run that along there, because that lightness against that dark contrast over there is what separates the top and the bottom beak. In this case, it's more a front and a back beak, eh? Few little funny lighted dots over there. So pop them in. Here I can see a little bit of light. Okay, now I'm going to wash the brush and pick up some black again, because this bottom edge over here, it needs to be filled in. Edge nice and solid and straight. And that's it. So now we've got the beak, eye and the face finished. Okay, so as before, we are now finished with these paints, but we don't want to get rid of them, because just in case we need some more. So I'm going to take my spare palette, and I'm going to store them. That way, at worst, I've also got a sample of each color that I did use. So if I ever needed to mix and match these colors while I'm still painting, I've got a sample. So like you can see there, that's not enough to really paint anything with, but at least I could match that color again, because I can still remember what colors I used there. Okay, so for now, let's take a look. We're going to be working with greens and blues and oranges. So yeah, we could possibly save that yellow ochre, but there's so little of it, I'm going to just dump it. Because what we will need to do now is we need to clean the palette. We don't want any of these greys mixing into our lovely vibrant yellows and oranges and things. So I'm going to get rid of all of this. The white, however, I can still use, so for now I'll put that on my spare palette. And that'll just make it easier for me to wash the whole palette without having to avoid a tiny little area. I'll throw that away. Tip a piece of kitchen towel. So I've got it well wet and I'm just dissolving that paint that's there. So it's first mixing and then it's dissolving. Right, once it's all dissolved, take your whole kitchen roll and just mop up the excess water. Done. Clean. Okay, so now we're back to the planning stage again to get ourselves a good little plan of attack. So remember we said we need to paint him before we can paint him. We need to paint him before we can paint him, and so on, to get that overlapping right. So at this point, we can basically paint that, then that, and then just keep some of the paint for here. And then we'll paint the green, because he overlaps the blue, and then we'll finish off with the orange. And then here and there, there's one or two little blues that do overlap the orange. We'll squeeze them in. And then right at the end, we'll come back with a last little bit of black. So for now, we'll need to mix some blues. So we can paint that. So what I do with a situation like this is I'm going to look for... how would I put it? Not quite a dark shadow color like that. Sort of my darkest mid-tone color. So I'm going to look for that. Then I can add highlights to it, and I can add shadows to it. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to first look for that darkest in-between color that we see over there, and that we see over here, which seems to be obviously roughly the same color. There's a good little example to mix as well. Nice little in-between color. And that way we can squeeze shadows in between and lovely highlights in between. And that gives us our three colors for 3D. Remember, we need three colors to make anything look three-dimensional. We need a mid-tone, a highlight, and a shadow. So let's go ahead and mix those colors. The main color there seems to be a cerulean. So let's pop a cerulean down. And we've got quite a bit of paint, quite a bit of area to cover, so I'll put it down a reasonable amount. We're going to need white, so I can bring my white from the palette, the white that I saved from earlier. Bring that back into the picture. And let's see, how are we going to darken that cerulean? Do we need to? So I'm going to pick up the paint, and I'm going to hold it over my screen at the correct area. See the tip of the knife? That's where I'm holding it against my screen to see what's missing or to see what do I need. So the first thing I'm interested in is taking a look at the tonal value. So at this point, I think my tonal value is good. So now I'm going to compare colors. So if I look at the color, it definitely needs a little bit more of a purpley look. but definitely a bit more of a French ultramarine look to it. So I'm going to take just a little bit of French ultramarine. Pop that down over there. So let's bring, seeing as now we're mixing, so we leave neat colors at the top, bring our colors down to mix. Yes, do that. Now let's just bring a little bit of French ultramarine in there to see what it does. Remember, you can always add more, you can't take any out. So we'll give it a good old work in and check it against your reference again. See how you're doing. All right, so we can add a bit more. Looking good, definitely getting closer. Definitely getting closer. By adding just that French ultramarine is actually giving it a nice, vibrant look. A deep color, but a nice vibrant color. It's going to look really nice. I can already start to see how nice that is going to look over here on top of this as a highlight. So I'm getting excited already. Oh yeah, look at that. That's fantastic. Okay. Yeah, I think that's a beautiful mid-tone. I'm going to stick with that. Okay, so let's move our mid-tone up here to the, a bit closer to the center of the palette, so we can mix a shadow and a highlight on either side. Then at least we've got the correct order. Okay, so let's take some more cerulean. And let's take a look at the highlights that we see over there. So that's definitely seems to be cerulean plus white. So let's pull out some of the cerulean here. That little paint that's there, there's nothing. Let's add just a little bit of white into it. Let's first see what does the white do. Does it make a big difference, a little difference, or no difference? In this case, no difference. So now I know I can scoop up a bit more. Okay, so now I've got a difference. Let's take a look and see. Is it enough of a difference? So if I look at that, it doesn't seem to be quite that highlight there yet. But it does seem to be somewhere around that area over there. Can you see the total value is looking pretty good? So I'm going to just check my color on the screen and see where we're at. Yeah, it can definitely still go lighter, but it is looking good. I'm quite happy with that. Let's pop all that white in and see where we get. It's looking great. I'm really happy with that. Then I think we can mix one lighter version. Let's get some more white over there. So I'm just going to take some white with the little bit of paint that's left on the knife. And mix that in. And that should give us a nice, just off-white. Yeah, that's great to see. 1, 2, 3. There's a nice contrast between there and there, and there and there, so I'm happy with that. Now, let's mix ourselves up the shadow color. So I think we can actually even just take some French ultramarine. And let's test that first. Because we can see it's going from white to cerulean to gradually more ultramarine in the mix. So let's bring some, we don't need too much of it, eh? They aren't pots of shadows. Okay, so now I'm taking that and I'm holding it over one of the shadow areas, like over there, and I'm going to compare it. Let's see, yeah, it's looking good. It's still a little bit too blue. The shadow seems to be a bit more of a neutral black. So we know how to mix our neutral black. We need a little bit of raw umber in it. So now this time I'm not going to do 50-50 because remember it's not black. It's more of a bluey black. So I'm going to take just a little bit of raw umber into it at first. So I'm mixing a black, but that black is now on the blue side. So now as I mix, I'm not looking at this big pile. I'm looking at as I mix, you get those little lighter areas like that. I'm looking at that. That's telling me what color I've got. Whether I need to add more raw umber or not. Okay, so this definitely, if I compare between there and there, I can see this is definitely darker. It's also definitely still blue, so that's great. So it's probably a good time to do a test. So test it against your reference again. Pick up the paint, nice and even over your length of your knife. Hold it up, see, oh, it's perfect, absolutely beautiful. Fantastic, so there's our four blues. We sorted on that guy. Okay, so for these two colors here, which is basically our two midtones, I'm going to mix just a few drops, 2 to 3 drops of water into it, just to adjust the consistency so that it's going to cover without us having to plaster it on. The other two, the dark and the light, we'll leave as is for now. We'll adjust him when we need to. Okay, so we're in the bottom right-hand corner below the beak. So let's start painting the feathers in this area over here. So I'm going to start just basically with a block in. Well, because what we want to do now initially is just get rid of the white of the canvas. So everything seems reasonably dark in this area, so I'm going to use my darker mid-tone. This guy over here. And I'm going to block the entire wing in. So now you do need to just be really careful to make sure that you don't go into the orangey area. And then also just make sure that you don't go over the edge. I'm rather going to stop just before the edge, so that I make sure that I'm not going over the side. Okay, so we've got a nice even coverage over there. So what are you going to do if you see that your color isn't exactly the same as what you've got on the photograph? Going to do nothing. As long as you've got the same tonal value, then you're A for away. Okay, so what I'm going to do now initially is just do a little bit of planning to see what goes where. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we need to get a bit of a feather effect. So I'm going to use a soft round brush like this. I'm going to use some of the darker shadow color, and I'm just going to plot out roughly where I'm seeing shadows. So now for this paint to lie on top of the previous one, it's going to need to be a little bit thinner, so just work in a bit of water. And don't panic about getting everything perfect, just more or less. We just want to get a feel for how do these how these feathers are growing. So let's see, we've got a nice, our main thing here is just to get a feel for the scale. Some really rough little plotting work going on over here. Can you see that? There's certainly no detail or anything at this point. Is my stuff identical? No, of course not. More or less in the right place? Absolutely. That's good enough for me. Okay, so let's take a look. We've got, now that we've got a feel for where the feathers come, I can see it's darker over there because this is casting a shadow. So I'm going to work some of the shadow in here to darken that area up. There like that. All this over here needs to go darker. So now we can add more paint over there. And now we're being just a little bit more deliberate with these shadows. So in areas where I can see, I've got really lovely deep shadows like over here. I'm going to pop them in. And over here, these guys are just sort of in between shadows, so I'm not going to make them too deep, and that's good enough. Okay, now I'm going to wash the brush, and I'm going to go over to my in between, my second mid-tone, second lightest mid-tone. And now let's take a look. Just using a little flicking motion, very lightly just add these little lighter areas in on each feather. Each one of those little dabs that I've put in, I'm going to fade it away from the sunlight. In other words, I'm going to fade it from the, so that it's lighter on the left and darker on the right. Being careful not to lose all your shadows. Okay, clean your brush. Now let's get a little bit more water into the highlight one. Because here now it needs to be thinner than the previous guy. So just a drop or two or three more. It doesn't need to be watery. Mix him in well until you see his colors returned. Back to normal again. Now let's take a careful look to see where does the sunlight shine. So we've got sunlight over here. There, like that. Nice flowing little strokes. Highlight over here. Highlight all the way running down there. We've got highlight on some of these feathers, these initial little feathers over here. Ones that are closest to the light. Alrighty, so now that you got your main colors in, let's just soften these guys out. Just gently soften it with your finger. And then wipe it on the cloth to clean your finger again. Remember, all these feathers are nice and soft, so you don't want to have all those hard lines in it. It's essentially just like sort of shadings. Okay, so once you're happy that you've softened all the lines away, but still, you can still see the definition of each of these feathers that you've created. So now I can just come back in with a softer brush again, and just make sure that you've got those last few little bits of definition to bring individual feathers out. So that's those little shadows. Bring in the odd little shadow, and then you'll also see that down some of these feathers you've got a little line running down in that direction there, like that, sort of down the center of the feather. I know that sometimes it sounds, this sort of feels like you're doing things in a roundabout way, but what happens is you're creating a mass first. And that's the whole idea. We're creating a mass, and then after that, we're coming back in and we're defining details. So initially, it feels sort of odd and counterintuitive, but that's just the way it works. If you had a straight away try and paint a mess, or straight away try and paint details, you're never going to get a nice little mess. So what I'm doing here is I'm just bringing in all those little shadows where the one feather casts a shadow on the other feather. Just bringing them back, and can you see how you've got that lovely depth there now? Let's wash the brush, then we go back to our highlight again. And we re-establish those last little highlights. So now we've got nice definition. So now also, just to get a little bit of a feel of for a feather effect, I'm also just putting this down in a bit of a stabbing effect. In other words, you're not going to try and paint every hair on every feather. It's not necessary. You're going to just suggest those hairs. And that's what we're doing now with the stabbing effect. So now, can you see most of your marks are all still in exactly where you left them? You've got your highlights and you've got your shadows and so on. Really light little very light touch. So yes, initially this does feel a little odd, but as you go along, it'll gradually make more and more sense as you get more practice with the technique. because let's now zoom in just on the photograph for a very short period of time. Can you see what's happening there? You've got hairs over hairs over hairs over hairs. But it's only the top hairs detail that you can see. So let me scroll down a little bit. Let's go and take a look a little bit further down. Can you see in an area like this? All you're really seeing is that mass. You're not seeing the individual hairs. Where in areas like this, we're seeing individual hairs. And the same thing is happening over here. Everywhere, you're seeing a big mass. Look at that. Can you see? There's a mass of feathers, one on top of the other. And you, it's just here. The top guys that you're seeing that detail. So initially we're creating a bit of a mess by doing all the putting the feathers in, smudging them, and then we come back and we create the individual feathers lying on top by adding the definition. Okay, so now we can go ahead and do the head area, head and the neck. And now that we stand back, can you see that lovely impression of detail that we've got in the feathers? Without having to actually paint each feather and each hair on the feather. Alrighty, so now it's all the way back to our darkest mid-tone color, the one that we originally blocked in over there. And now we can do the same thing over here. So you'll see here at the top, we do have those little overlapping feathers, but when we painted our background, we specifically went into that area where those feathers are. Which means you can't see that overlapping area anymore. So when you're doing this little initial block in, don't try and add that overlapping effect yet. If you look carefully, you'll see that overlapping all happens with the highlight color. So we're not going to add that now. That comes right at the end. And then over here, where the green and the blue meet, just when you see there's less paint on your brush, so you're blocking in, you're blocking in, you're blocking in, and eventually the paint starts sort of just smudging like that, so you're not getting a nice coverage. Come back over here and just pull that a little bit into where the green is, like that. What that does is it gives you that little bit of green that you need, or that little bit of blue that you need, so that when you do have green and you've got the two colors overlap and meet each other, then at least you've got that little bit of blue there to appear as though there's blue underneath the green. So here, while I was working, when I was doing my initial drawing work, I did draw out where these heavy shadows are. So if you've done that hard work, then you don't really want to lose all that hard work again, right? So just do this. Pick up paint. And then on the edge, put down lots of paint and just gently fade it away. So same as what we were doing there with the beak. Remember, we left a little bit of a gap between there. So we're doing the same, similar type of effect over here. We've got lots of paint, less paint, lots of paint, less paint. And that gives you that little bit of a separation there between them. But if you do lose those lines, it's really not a crisis. Because these feathers really do look different within seconds. The minute the bird moves, the feathers look different. Can you you see that? So you've got less paint, more paint. So there where the less paint is actually where your shadow is going to end up. And then if you're wondering what brush I'm using, this is a Simply Simmons range from Daler-Rowney, and it's the bristle short filbert. Now because it's got that rounded filbert edge, see that? It gives you that nice little edge that you need for defining these feathers. But you must always still remember, even though you are now sort of defining a few feathers and things, at the end of the day your task now is to cover up the canvas. To get rid of the white. So don't get so carried away working on getting these shapes of the feathers right that you forget to cover up the canvas. Because it's easy to do that. That's why I mention it. Alrighty, we could carry on down here into the other wing, but I think for now let's stop there. Okay, so let's go to a small fine round and go to our shadow color again, and let's just define where these heavy little shadows are. So now just remember, you're not painting everything, it's not perfect. We're plotting stuff out. We just want to figure out where are things, where are they going to go. Here in this area things are pretty flat, so I'm going to just add a few little suggestions of shorter feathers over there, casting little shadows. There's really not much. That's over here where things start getting long. So can you see we're already starting to get that feel of just short little feathers and things over here? Like that, and then longer feathers going on over here. And here at the bottom again we've got some shorter guys just doing that. A nice little bit of plotting out work going on there. Okay, so let's plot out where do our highlights go. So exactly the same procedure as before. So I'm going to take my lighter mid-tone color. But because we've got a nice big area over here, I'm going to stick with this big filbert brush that we were using for blocking in here. And now we can use nice little, just lovely free little movements. Here we've got short feathers, so short little dabs in the directions like this. Can you see how it's already starting to form us that little mess? So these lighter areas are more sort of on the right hand side. So here we can now slowly start to suggest a few little overhangs, overlapping pieces of feather. So they're more over there, they're more over towards the tip of the feather. So it's right up against the little shadows that you plotted in. So don't worry if you've got lines like that. Remember, we're going to still shade it all the way with our finger. Alrighty, it's already looking good, eh? Okay, so now back to the finger. So I'll just take a look here and see how much of the smoothing do you need to do. So don't forget to every now and again just clean your finger. The main thing that we're trying to do is just get rid of all the any super hard edges that we have for now. Because we're creating a mess. And you can't see any detail in the mess. So we're basically suggesting little shadings and things at the moment. You see I'm fading that inwards. So I've got that on the tip of the feather. And I'm fading it inwards. Light, mid-tone, dark. Light, mid-tone, dark. But all with little shadings. Okay, so now take a look at a very interesting thing has happened. Just by fading all that, the effect over here is pretty much sorted. Can you see that? Because there's no real detail over there. Here we're seeing detail with individual feathers and stuff. There, the top there has just become a big mass. So what I'm going to do is wash this nice full bit of mine. Pick up a little bit of the highlight color. Remember to add just an extra drop of or two of water in it, just so that it's thinner and it can lie on top of the previous paint. And I'm just going to take a look and see where are those little highlights. I'm going to just, and now is also a good time for me to flick in these little overlapping guys. Absolute feather-like touch, these little flicks. Now what's really important when you do this is don't overdo it, because then you're just going to flatten out everything you've done before. So you don't want to do that. So one more over there and less over here to get that effect that there's more sunlight over there and there's less over here. So as we head out towards the neck area, you're basically highlighting the highlights that you added on before. Okay, and then now you come back in with your shadow color again. And you just recreate those little definitions. Okay, there we go. Now we've got some nice definition over there. Okay, so I'm sticking with a small brush. Get our highlight color, and now let's really define a few of these guys. In other words, I'm just making these edges sharper. Okay, I think what we can do now is wash our brushes, and then we go ahead and do that green bit to finish the top of the head. So to get that green is literally going to be, the effect itself is going to be more of the same. So I think I'll take a little bit of sap green. It seems lovely dark, so that's a great shadow color for us. Then to highlight it, let's take say a bit of cadmium yellow. We put a bit of cadmium yellow down there. And as you can see, I'm just mixing a little bit. We don't need much. Take some sap green into the yellow. Oh yeah, that's our color, all right. So I'm really happy with that. And then there's even less. It's just a little bit of, take some of this and add some white to it. To give us that last little bit of sunlit. On the top of the head, just that little bit of sunlit green. Okay, so it's not a large area, so I think I'll just stick with this little fine round that we used. Let's get, say, just one drop into the neat sap green so that we can let it flow. In actual fact, that area is just a little bit big still, so let's maybe go over to one of our bristle brushes again. Let's rather block it in with that. We don't want to use our soft brushes for blocking in large areas, because that will destroy the brush very quickly. Soft brushes are not for blocking in, they are just for detail work. Okay, so let's block this whole area in. I think we'll just do it in with the darkest color, doesn't really matter. Okay, I'm also just avoiding the skin area. I'm not painting into the skin. Just before it for now. Just until that initial blocking in work is done. Then we'll come back in with the correct colors. Okay, so we know we've got to go all the way around there like that. So as before, over there, remember we did that little bit of flicking kind of work with almost no paint on the brush. We're going to do exactly the same thing over there. Just gently flick it up like that, into that. So what's happening is those two paints are now, the little bit of paint that is there is now mixing with each other, and that's giving us that perfect little in-between color that we need. Okay, this goes all the way around here like that. just disappears. Okay, we do have just here and there a little bit of greens inside of here, so I'm just tapping it in. Quick little flicks. That's great. Alright, so now let's start off with our shadows. We've got some really dark shadows over there. So this green isn't going dark enough on its own. So I'm going to take some of our darkest blue and mix it into the darkest, into the sap green. That'll give us a really dark green. Because green is yellow and blue, right? So by adding more blue into the green, I'm darkening our green. Almost a bit of a black. So that goes all the way around there like that. That sort of just fades away upwards. Okay, now over here on this edge, also got some really dark greens over here. There's a little bit of dark over there too. I'll just very gently work that in over there. Alrighty, so let's just, seeing as we're working with greens, so I'm not going to wash the brush, I'm just going to wipe the worst off. Let's use our mid-tone green. And this stuff here is all really short, it's even shorter than that over there, so I'm going to stick with this brush and I'm just going to just gently tap in like this. Flick and tap. These short hairs. So when you do it, don't have too little paint on your brush. Have enough paint on the brush. So now notice how I've left the darks over there. Okay, let's wash our brush, and now we're going to over to the highlight color. So I'll zoom in so you can see the effect. Can you see that? Very light little flicks. With lots of paint on the brush. Plenty of paint on the brush. So initially I want lots over here because I need to create a separation. Remember we've got green against green, so we need to create a separation between the foreground and the bird. And then as we come in we need to have less and less flicks. And this is identical to the flick that I've been using all the time. Okay, shorter and shorter flicks. To create sort of a shading using flicks. I think I may even take a little bit more white, add it to this green, and just add a few more lovely little highlights just on that point over there, just to really force a separation. Between the bird and the background. Alright, let's zoom out and see what does our painting look like so far. Yeah, I think we're coming along quite nicely. And guess what? We're nearly done too. Believe it or not. Because this year is all one, basically just one color and more of the same. Almost. There's a little twist to this technique because as you can see, the hairs are a lot more closer to each other, a lot more sort of matted, and forming more of a solid mass as opposed to individual feathers like we have over there. So let's go back to over here and get a little plan of attack. Okay, so can you see that? Yeah, we're seeing individual feathers, individual feathers, individual feathers. Yeah, not so much. You're seeing it's more like a different, a gradual change of shading from the one to the next eye. And just here and there, a few little suggestions of actual hairs on the feathers. So what we're going to do, we're going to mix up, say, one, two, yeah, about three colors. You see, dark, a mid-tone, and a light. So our normal standard three colors for 3D. So let's take a look. So we've got all that over there. So I think it's probably a good time to get everything off the palette again. Because blues and oranges are opposite on the color wheel, which means if you mix them together, you're going to end up with a brown. We don't want a brown, we want lovely, vibrant oranges. So let's take all these colors and transfer them to our spare palette. So then we can wash this palette again and get it spotlessly clean. Alrighty, so that's what our spare palette looks like at this stage. There's the greens and there's the blues. So we'll carefully collect the white area there that hasn't got any paint on it or any other colors in it. And I'll do the same with the blue and the ultramarine. Pop them down over there so we can use them again. And now we can wash this palette. Fantastic. Now we can bring our white back. So let's see, what kind of colors do we need there? There's definitely like a lemon yellow. Nice, lovely, bright yellow. Look at that. Yep. Sure is it. In actual fact, that lemon yellow may even, it's to highlight it, we'll need to add some white. And then to shadow it, let's start by adding a bit of yellow ochre. I think a touch of orange in it as well, because the yellow ochre is going to darken it and shadow it. But we'll just keep it bright with just a tiny touch of orange in there. Not too much, it's still yellow. Still yellow. Alright, so let's take a look. Let's mix up our highlights. So we take the yellow and the white, mix them together. Looks pretty great. A beautiful bright yellow, isn't it? Cool. Right in between, got that. Possibly even a little bit darker. So let's maybe take some cadmium yellow. Just add that straight in there, just a little bit, not too much. Oh wow, look at that. That has actually formed us our a bit of a darker mid-tone, to be honest. Oh, who would have thought? Okay, so let's take some more cadmium yellow. Let's pop him down there. get our yellow ochre in it. And just a tiny touch of orange. And let's see. Oh yeah, that's a lovely, lovely dark over there. I am seeing one spot where there's a really dark yellow. But I think we'll just mix him as we need. So I suspect if we put some neat lemon yellow down there, that might get us where we need to be. Because we want to make sure that there's a good contrast between there, and there, and there, and there, and there, and there. Okay, so only thing I'm seeing is nice flow between the colors over there, and then from here to here there's a little bit of a jump. So I'm going to take just a little bit of this and pop it in here, and that'll marry those two colors together. I've got an even jump between there, 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 and there, because the yellow ochre is becoming less and the lemon yellow is becoming more. And as we go from here, the white is becoming less, the yellow lemon, the lemon yellow becoming less. So I think we've got a nice little flow of colors over there. So we start here with our intermediate colors, as before. And as before, just one or two drops inside the two mid-tone colors. Just to improve its flow without thinning it down too much. Things are starting to repeat themselves, aren't they? Okay, so I'm going to stick with my bristle brush. That will block pretty much everything in that we need. So there is a bit of black over there. So now be careful that you don't want to touch the blue. Be super careful that you don't touch the blue. So I'm going to well avoid that. Because the blue and the yellow is going to give you a green. We don't want the green. And we don't want the orange to, or the yellow to touch the black or anything. Let's keep this color nice and clean by making sure it doesn't touch anything it doesn't need to. So if necessary, stay well clear of the other colors, like I'm doing there now. So I'm getting it covered. Using the least amount of paint that I can. Okay, so let's see over there. We do have a little bit of yellow in that area there. So I just want to catch the definition of this a little bit better. Yeah, I think that's fine over there. This guy comes around there, we've got some black going along there. And that comes out over there, I think that's a better definition of that, eh? Yeah, I think so. Alright, so this edge over here, we can just do that light little bit of paint overlapping. Remember like we did over there with that tiny amount of paint. There solid, there and there will have to go in nice and neat. All right, so let's start creating our definition over here. We can see over there is getting darker, so I'm going to take my shadow color. Seems to be from around there, like that kind of a thing. I think let's get that color all the way into here using a smaller brush. So we have that little bit of a fold over there where the wing and the body meet each other. So we've got that kind of a thing going on over there. So this is all darker over here. This is all darker over here. So can you see I'm ignoring all the, I'm not worrying about the feather effect or anything like that. Okay, and the same thing is happening over there. So let's take with this color, and it seems to end a little bit wobbly over there, so we'll do that. Let's work in that shadow next to it. And that shadow sort of just really quickly fades away, so that's good enough for over there. Let's take a look. Over here we've got a little bit of shadow, and that shadow seems to run along there and there. Possibly even a little bit higher up like that. Over here there's some darks over there. Where those guys meet. And here there's some little shadows and things going on over there. There I see a nice little shadow. There's a nice little shadow. And all this over here is slightly darker. So here we've just got little shadings that we're doing now. I'm just trying to get a feel for which direction do all these little shadings go in. There's no real hard edges or anything, so I'm softening all these edges up. So it's one shading into the next. Okay, let's get rid of the worst on that. Now let's go over to the lighter mid-tone color. So I'm sticking with the same brush as well. And let's see, where do we see these lighter colors? We're seeing them over here. seeing them over here. So I'm just popping them in with a bit of a stabbing motion at the moment in the direction that I see these, the hairs on the feather are moving, just sort of mimicking that direction. So now you do need to just be careful that if you do snap up a little bit of blue or so by mistake, to just carefully work it in, and then also just carefully clean your brush just on the kitchen towel, just carefully work it in and just wipe off any excess so that you don't end up with green in here. So I'm going as close to the blue as what I can without touching it. So if you need to go slower and slower, do it. Remember, this is not a race. Take your time. Now notice how I'm following the directions of the hairs. Yeah, the hairs are going in this direction. Yeah, the hairs are going in this direction. And here, these hairs are going in this direction. And I'm working really quick and loose with a flicking motion. So I'm starting to get a bit of, almost a bit of a hair effect. Can you see that? It's a little bit stripy, but it's not individual hairs. There's no individual details. Right, let's go over to the smaller brush now, because now we need to get this edging effect right. Let's get that where these hairs meet each other. Let's get them correct. So I'm going to stick with a lighter mid-tone color. And I'm going to add just a few little flicks at a time. I've got my cloth like this. So look what I'm doing. I'm putting a flick like that, and I'm wiping my any excess on the brush, because that excess over there is now green. So yes, there are some green feathers as well. But in general, you don't want any greens. So just be patient while you're doing this overlapping piece. I know it does take a while, but there's nothing much you can do about it. Not if you want to paint impasto anyway. If you are going to be painting, leaving this guy to dry, then you can obviously come back, not a problem, and add your flicks in. Here at the top, I'm actually using some of the shadow color, because this is quite dark in this area here. here I'm also adding some of the shadow color as well. I'm letting it mix with the blue to give me that bit of a shadow effect over there. Alrighty, so let's go over to a smaller bristle brush, and now let's pick up our highlight color. And let's start adding in these little areas. So take a look what you've done. You've made a shadow area and a lighter area. So you've created yourself some overlapping. So now you need to be more careful and more measured with where you're putting these flicks down. Because now you're suggesting individual feathers. So look carefully to see where these lovely highlights are and the shapes that these feathers are creating. So like over here, I can see these feathers going in this direction, and I'm adding these highlights obviously more on the lighter and brighter bits. Area of those feathers. Light flicks, super, super light flicks. Can you see the nice effect we're getting? And as we move over to this side, we are now getting less light, so we do need to add less of this. So what you do is, if you do add in, then all you do is just keep working over it. Like that. You see what happens? Then the colors gradually mixing with the colors underneath it. Okay, so what you do is you keep going over that same area, so then you're getting less and less detail because you're now working away a lot of those individual lines that you can see. You're working them away. And the colors mixing with the color underneath it. So guess what happens? Look what happens. You've got that bright color there is gradually getting darker and darker and darker. Okay, so now once you're happy with that, now go in everywhere and just continue to blend like that. But can you see what's happening? Because I'm not picking up new paint, it's just moving the paint that's there around. So you're ending up with some lights in between the darks, and some darks in between the lights, and that's giving us that lovely natural hair effect, that matting that you get with the hair. The hair on the individual hairs on the feathers. Okay, so let's see, what details do we need to take care of? We've still got that fold over there, and we've still got that fold over there. They need to go darker. There's some darker areas over there, which I think we'll be able to take care of when we put that in. But for now, we can tackle that, and we can tackle that. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take this darkest color over here, and we're going to add just a touch of raw umber into it to darken it. So think I'm going to add just a tiny touch of orange into that as well. Just to keep the color nice and alive. Okay, and I'm just adding a few little lines over there to keep the impression of the directions of the hairs and so on. Let's keep that right. Alright, let's do the same on the other side. There we've got that really dark shadow over there. Hair effect back. And I think we can just add a little bit more orange into the mix. Not quite enough. It's gone a little bit too brown, eh? Wow, well look at that, we are nearly finished. Alrighty, let's finish off this little bit of wing over here. Okay, so we block him in with our second darkest, our darker mid-tone color, same as before. Now notice how I've avoided that little bit of yellow there, eh? Okay, and I'm going to have to go to a smaller brush. Get the shadow color, and let's just define let's get a feel for how do these little feathers go over there. There's not too much going on, I think that's almost enough. Let's take our lighter mid-tone color. Let's add our little shadings to it. So it seems to be lighter at the top and lighter on those sides of the. Yeah, it's quite interesting this one, eh? Around there, around there. Like that. Get rid of all these hard edges to form a mess. Okay, let's get our shadow color again. Let's get definition back. Fill darks there. Ducks there, shadow running there, alright, so now we need to just get that tie in between the yellow and the blue. So what I've done is I've just added myself just one or two little loops like that to show you the bottom of each feather. And now we'll just gently fade them in. Just like that, that's good enough. I think we can maybe just take a little bit more yellow, curve it into the blue again. So if you do that, just remember to wash your brush in between each stroke. we go. Now it's not a solid mass anymore. And let's get a highlight. There's not too much highlight, so we just add a little bit of highlight over there. So, because most of the highlights is now off the out of the painting. That's good enough. Okay, let's also just see whether that guy is supposed to curl that way. It's not curling the right way. Okay, so now we can go over there. Now we can bring back this black that we used. Our neutral black that we mixed with the French ultramarine and the raw umber. Okay, let's lock it in with the black. Okay, so over here I'm gonna just bring it out till before the yellow. We obviously now need to get our feather effect and the tie-in and all that kind of stuff right. So let's do around there. Okay, so over here on this edge I'm going to just add one or two little light flicks like we did the top of the head. Very gentle little flicking effect like that. And that'll be enough to get that feathered tie-in. More than enough. So just keep looking at your directions that these feathers are in. Okay, now here, as I'm moving down, I'm going to take all that extra paint off the brush. Can you see over here, this sort of a bit of a greeny effect? Now that green is simply the black mixing with the green on the feathers. So by taking all that excess off the paintbrush, it's automatically going to give me the green, exactly the correct green. So I'm going to just continue exactly the same feather effect as what I was painting over there. I'm going to paint it over here using a clean paintbrush. So if you do find that you are picking up too much black, wipe your brush off on the kitchen towel, same as before. Okay, so over here we've got this funny little feather that's coming out like that. I quite like that idea. So we'll definitely have to work him in. Here we've got some lighter grayer kind of feathers, and there's some darker yellow feathers. So let's get some shadow yellow in there first. Yeah, it's mixing with the blue. That's just fine. It's going to look like it's in lovely shadow there. Okay, now we're going to take this black color and mix just a tiny, tiny, tiny amount of white into it. Well, let's start off with too little white. It's easy to add more. What we're looking for is that bit of a gray, because now we need to now go and define feathers in there, same as before. So that's all I'm working on now, is just getting that definition of individual feathers and things right over here. Now we can gradually add a little bit more white. and I'm just controlling the amount of white in the mix. Get the correct effect and total value. Alright, so the only thing that's missing is that guy over there. So he seems to have lots of white in this area over here. So just a few little very light dabs. And then there's a feather that curling out that way there, like that. So now I don't want that to look all alone, kind of odd, something new that we've added. So we will have to add some of this color at other places as well, just to get a tie-in. To show you that there are other feathers with this color too. And with that, our parrot is finished. And I think you'll agree with me. I think we've got a really beautiful effect using the water mixable oil paints. So I hope you enjoyed the class. Good luck painting your parrot. I'll see you for part 3, where we're going to be painting a grisaille and glazing technique using the Daler-Rowney water mixable oil paints. I'll see you then.